Thank you for coming today, Andrew. I've had a look at some of our collections of amulets. Did any pique your interest in particular?
Well, I think it's more that the whole collection is so extraordinary. I can't remember how many objects you said you'd got altogether, but...
Of this particular collection, 5,000.
5,000, all collected, nearly all collected by Adrien de Mortelet. Mm-hmm. Well, first of all, I'm fascinated by the collection itself as a symbol of a particular time and place, and I think it's very much a reflection of this burgeoning interest in modern secular France, the France of, you know, Picasso, the Wright brothers flying across
the world.
Yeah, this sort of this new world, the sort of the world of the First World War, this world of advancing technology, and at the same time, there's this fantastic interest in the primitive. And de Mortelet's principal interest, as I understand it, was collecting ethnographic objects from ancient cultures. Mm. But what he's also fascinated by is this, what he saw as this persistence of ancient tribal beliefs and customs into the modern world. So he's interested in ex votos, the objects that people hang up in church, like these wonderful ones here. Mm-hmm. Very simple, but rather touching, you know. You hang it up in the church in the hope that your head will get better, your leg will get better, your finger will get better. Beautiful little, I like these little beaten metal ones. And they're very simple works of art. I do think of them as works of art, but they're popular art, they're folk art. Mm-hmm. And each one of them taps into a very particular ancient form of human superstition. It's a collection of objects, but I also think that each object is, in a sense, represents a particular feeling or a particular hope. So I always think, you know, that while relics and reliquaries and amulets are often connected with death or disease, they're also very much about life. That they're about the emotions that all of us feel, the hope that someone we love may get cured, or the hope that we may, you know, end up in a better place than we are now.
So do you think with the passage of time, these things lose that power and they just become curiosities, or do they still have that resonance for you?
Well, it depends on your point of view. I mean, I think, for example, that almost rather grand old reliquary containing a number of bones of saints, that might well be regarded with quite a lot of reverence by a modern Catholic. Richard Dawkins would say it's just a bunch of old bones and it has no power at all. But the fact that people such as him feel the need to rant on about it in the way that they do suggests that whether anybody likes it or not, these objects do still have a certain power, at least over people's imaginations.
Mm-hmm. And a lot of the critics would say, but, you know, so many of these reliquaries contain fake bits of bone, fake bits of hair. Does that really matter?
Well, I mean, I'm not a religious believer, so to me it doesn't particularly matter. And I would doubt very much that those really are relics of Francis Xavier, the founder of the Jesuit movement. I would very much doubt that St. Joseph's bone is lodged in that little reliquary over there. I think what this is, if you like, is that it's a mini museum of belief. And that's what's interesting about it. To me, it doesn't really matter whether what is believed is true.
Yeah.
In lots of cases, it probably isn't. But, you know, what was believed is in itself just rather fascinating. I love these strange snail shells wrapped in cloth, which apparently reflect a belief that if you gathered the snails from the wall of a particular church in France and wore them around your neck until the snail had rotted away, you'd get better. But you had to put the snail shell back in the church, and that's what these are. I mean, how potty is that? But it's absolutely in the Pitt River's tradition of slightly potty collections.
Yes.
That it sort of connects you with things that you wouldn't necessarily think about. Well, in fact, it's a triple potty collecting whammy, isn't it? Because de Mortelet apparently was so obsessed by his collecting habits that by the end of his life he only had a chair and a bed and was living in a garret. He'd bankrupted himself to collect this vast store of amulets. Yeah. Welcome, we all know, sort of almost was submerged by his own collection, and Pitt Rivers, as we can see, was hardly a slouch. Yes. So there's a sort of, it's, you know, there's something rather wonderful about the fact of all the three coming together in this way.
Yeah, and that power of just the sheer quantity is quite powerful. Yeah.
Well, once collectors of a certain type start collecting objects of a certain type, and if those objects are freely available, there really is sometimes no end to it, and that's what this collection suggests to me.
Finally, do you have any superstitions yourself? Would you ever carry around something as a lucky charm or anything like that?
Not currently, but I'm thinking of it, you know, maybe. I'm thinking maybe, you know, what would be an appropriate amulet for an art critic?
What would you choose from our table?
Know. Well, from your table, I don't know. Well, I quite like this. Goodness knows what it is.
Got a lot of corrosion on it.
What does it say?
Amulet against evil eye.
Well, there you go. That's the art critic's. That's the art critic's amulet. I'll just take this home with me if that's all right. No, it's okay. I'll leave it with you. Oh, it's worn worn by horses in Naples.
Oh yes.
1704. You find out something every day. Why would a horse wear an amulet against the evil eye? Well,
there's quite a lot of them in the museum, actually. Amulets specially made for animals.
Oh, right. Well, you get this...
Keep them strong, keep them healthy.
Yes, of course, because your horse is one of your most valuable possessions, so you don't want your horse to get the evil eye.
Yeah.
Good. Great. Well, listen, it's been a pleasure.
Thank you very much for coming in. Thank you.
I feel I've learned more than I've revealed to you, but it's been a pleasure.